I think many of us are challenged on these holiday, religious holiday times, to feel comfortable about the events, especially during Holy Week. And this is with youth and with adults as well. I grew up in a town, Klondike, Wisconsin, right at the foot of Lake Winnebago for you fishermen. A town of about 25,000. And the region around this was rather equally divided between Roman Catholic and Protestant. The Roman Catholics had their own high school, not a grade school. They had an academy. They had a convent where they taught girls to be nuns. They had a Catholic nursing school, and they had a Catholic hospital. That brought back fond memories, the Catholic hospital. They were extremely strict, and the quicker you could get out of there, the better your life was. When it comes to Holy Week, I had some problems. Before confirmation, I learned quite a bit in confirmation, but before confirmation, I couldn't put this whole thing together. For example, Thursday after Ash Wednesday service, I noticed many of my Catholic friends had the ashes on their forehead. Asking what it was about, they said, "We got it last night at church." It looked kind of neat. My dad and myself, we always came home for lunch at noon. We were close enough that we could do that. So when I went home for noon, I rushed downstairs in the coal bin, got a piece of coal, and put a dot up there. When my mother saw it, I thought she was going up through the roof. She said, "We don't do that. Only the Catholics do that." I said, "What's it for?" "I don't know." I looked at my dad and he said, "Wash it off, son." And use the phrase that we use so much. He said, "If mama's not happy, nobody's happy. Wash it off." Then came Good Friday. And as long as I could remember, on Good Friday, we had fish. Where'd that come from? From the Catholic side. So on Wednesday night, Mother was against this. On Friday, we ate fish. So you can understand that things get mixed up. She wasn't just sure where she fit in, so she worked both sides of the road, so to speak. Easter, well, Easter wasn't quite as bad. Until my father passed away, and he died in August. And I was thinking, if he had to die, I wish he died in February, he wouldn't have had to wait so long for the resurrection. It wasn't until I had first year seminary that I figured out, oh, wait a minute, that's not how it works. And so even as adults, we have some mixed feelings about what happens during Holy Week, what happens on this Palm Sunday. Why did Jesus travel to Jerusalem when he knew he was going to be killed? From early on, he said, "This was my mission. This is what I need to do." But the disciples never really caught that. They never really caught that. A little bit like my mother. They were on both sides. Well, yeah, I think he means it. No, he doesn't mean it. Perhaps you've wondered why he chose to come into Jerusalem on a donkey, the foal of an ass. I mean, surely there was other ways. Or he could have walked. Why that one? And those of you who know about animals also know that a donkey that's never been sat on could present some real problems. But nothing happened. Nothing happened at all. Why did he do that? How is it possible for a crowd on Palm Sunday to lay branches down before him and lay their garments down so that he and the donkey could walk on it and shout, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." And then on Friday, they crucify him. What's going on? How do we reconcile all of this? Well, Jesus chose to return to Jerusalem on the Passover because that was the time of the year of the Jewish repentance and the time for their forgiveness. And God wanted to make a sacrifice that was far beyond the lamb. He wanted to make a sacrifice that would cover the original sin of mankind. And that was his son. The usual sacrifice of the lamb wasn't going to do it. God wanted to pull all of his people back to him, as he had originally intended, but we screwed that up. And so this was his son's mission. And how was he going to do that? Well, the formula was in the 118th Psalm that Jim read this morning. How he was to enter into which gate, and how he was to be received by the people. Jesus always said that this was the way it was going to be. But as I've said previously, nobody recognized that. Nobody really went along with that. But he was to be the eternal priest, prophet, and king. The people mistook his purpose. And things didn't go away. So now we are. We're in the Holy Week. On Monday, he goes into the temple and raises pure havoc, overturns the tables, chases people out. Then he comes back and raises another havoc with the scribes and the Pharisees, almost like he's provoking something. Until he had the scribes and the Pharisees so mixed up that they didn't even know their Old Testament law. And they couldn't say anything back to him. But he was a king. Not the kind of king that was going to ride in Jerusalem on a white stallion bedecked with robes, but on a lowly donkey, the symbol of meekness and mildness. Because my kingdom, quote, is not of this world, but of the world to come. And so some people understood and put the branches and the garments down. But that was a small group. That was a small group. 6 days later, this lowly king became the greatest sacrifice and the greatest priest by giving up his life for the sins of the world. The triumphant entry was almost like the last plea that Jesus could make to the world. If you're going to get in on this, you got to do it now. There's only so much time left. But their mind was also bent on, we got to get rid of him. And plans were being made on how to best do that without causing major riots during the festival of the Passover. And they began. It was a joyous occasion on Palm Sunday, not well attended by huge crowds, but the crowd that was there, they were joyous. They were happy. They thought that this was really the beginning of a new age. It wasn't. It was still part of the old. Even though they were the ones who said, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, yet there were those who were skeptics. They were there. They were maybe protesting. And if I'm not careful, I will make some political statements that will not be appreciated. There was a gathering storm. They were building up against the Christ. And out of a fear of reprisal, the small group that said Hosanna didn't say anything on Good Friday. It was okay to do it on Sunday when it looked like there wasn't going to be much trouble. But on Friday, when the crowd was larger and obviously more organized and more angry, they were silent. They were silent. And the question remains, if we have a Palm Sunday processional today, and the Christ comes into Wabash, how are we going to stand? Are we going to be with the group that puts the palms and the garments down, accepting him as our Lord and Savior? If we are, what are we going to do on Good Friday? Stay home? Not expose ourselves? Or are we in the other side that says, well, now that's a small group, that's a minority. The safe thing here is to go with the majority. And we do that a lot, especially when we elect our officials. Behold, your king is coming. And we wonder what we would do if he's coming to Wabash this week. How would we respond? What would we do about that? The church through the ages has always celebrated Palm Sunday, I think, in the right mood. It's not a overjoyous occasion. It is joyful, but we are so aware of what happens 4 or 5 days later that it tones down our joy, doesn't it? A few would hail him. A few would understand his majesty. But probably the most would be living in indifference. It'll come and go, and things will be the same. How will you receive him? Father, that's a hard question. We really don't want to expose ourselves to unpleasantries. We don't want to be on the wrong side of things if they go bad. But help us to recognize that Christ came to save everyone, and that we need to respond to him in a kindly way. Be with us now through this Holy Week. Help us with our own indecisions, our own quandaries, our challenges. For we ask it in his name. Amen.